hear that bell ringing just a few minutes ago? I think forward when they're ringing it, what they always said about it. When it started raining, letting everybody know it's time for church to start. So the bell had rang, so the time has changed. We're just going to, as a program, we have a program that's kind of part of the program and outline. Of course, we always leave room for the Holy Spirit.
My brother, did he show up?
Just going to kind of follow the outline. When you see, we'll start off with a prayer. I want to say a whole lot more, but it ain't on the program. Maybe I get a chance to say it later. I'm excited.
Thirdly, in 2010, the building was
change, name was changed to Roy Henry Education Center, and the purpose of that was to honor the love pastor that has been, I think, about 20-plus years as pastor in that particular building. Dustin also, based on that, the intent also is to have a computer room that students can come after school and work on a computer and do research, and also have the capability or the ability to print all of what they have researched and paper going, because I've come to understand that everybody doesn't have a computer at home. Sometimes, since I've been doing a lot of research, I find that the library seems like it's full all the time. So we wanted a place to provide for students in all schools to be able to come in and do research and do homework and such as that. Of course, our desire, my intent in the purchasing of computers and a printer based on donation. There has been some suggestion on how we want to utilize the sanctuary. One has been made that we use it for Sunday school, for the men's Sunday school class, possibly use it as a Bible study, a prayer meeting area, also possibly use the building itself as a church for our children's church, and also use it for weddings, or anniversaries, or something along that line. If you haven't ever been over there, it takes beautiful pictures. There's a glow to it, there's a background to it. So if anybody has a desire, you know, at least seats about 150. So if anybody has a desire, want to have a wedding over there, there's a business to be made for that. Or they want to have a silver anniversary or a golden anniversary or something of those lines. There's possibilities of what the sanctuary itself can be used for. And then, of course, we'll allow us to name the Cooper at Vacation Bible School over there as well. Amen. And the children run up down the stairs like some of us have in the years. Some of the suggestions for the downstairs, we've already pretty much declared it for you, being declared as a building historical area. As we go through the history, we realize that there are many churches that use that particular building. As Sister Dixie Hill called it, the Incubator Church. A lot of churches got their start when it was built there. I mean, they was already formed, and they didn't necessarily have a location or a location such as that. So we go through and we know the different denominations utilize the church throughout time. So we want them to display any artifacts or any history that they may have procured while they were in that particular building at that time. So the foyer area has been kind of designated as the historical area to be used for that purpose. And when we go into the big back area, we're looking at it as possible being used for a conference room or a classroom, set up chairs and tables, whatever someone might want to do with it. Maybe even use it for possibly having a little birthday party, you know, whomsoever, or maybe even a wedding. What to do before the wedding? Baby shower or something like that. Ceiling is heaven. There's an unlimited possibility of the capability that we can utilize the building for. Here again, we want to acknowledge the building. We talked about it. All of us members remember what the old kitchen was. What we did with it is put it into a room, an office type room. And just a couple of thoughts about how to utilize that would be possibly maybe even put the secretary over there, or financial clerk over there, or maybe even rent it out for someone to use as an office building. I kind of like that idea personally myself, because that means someone is there all the time. Building will be used, people in and out, if somebody come by with a tour. Though they're not there for the purpose of the tour guide, but they'll be there just to have somebody there if someone wanted to come and visit in it. And I got one of my good friends, Charles Madeline. He's the owner of the Madeline Tour, Bus and Tour, that I've been talking to him about, seeing about renting out. But anyway, the church hadn't made a decision on what we're going to do. Don't quote me on that. But anyway, it is the option. Here again, who knows, since it was Mr. Jones' purpose for the building to be used by anybody, regardless of race, creed, or color, to teach and preach Jesus Christ crucified, may use this building to take on the responsibility. Maybe even the incubator church and all of the churches that started using it, maybe they'll jump on board and help keeping it up as well. And as we look at that, we look at a full circle, 212 years after Mr. Jones stated intent for that church to be used here again and to be used by anybody preaching the teaching of Jesus Christ. And I want to say thanks to here again other churches that have helped me out. Over the past few months, I've been meeting with a couple of representatives from East Church, Sister Dixie Hills. And as you go over there, you'll see a board made of, I think it's 4x8 groups, with a timeline. We owe all that to Sister Dixie Hill, that being the orchestrator of that. And she's from the Methodist Church. We also had Tony and Carolyn Goodman from the Baptist Church, assisted in developing the timeline. They brought information from their own churches to be able to put them on that timeline. And we also thank Sister Linda Shoney, did I say that correctly? Sonia, from the Presbyterian Church. And then we also was out there one day and Pastor Linton. And I've done a lot of research on the church, but I'd never seen this anywhere. But he shared with me that St. John's Abbey Zion also worshiped in that building. So I took what he said and I began to find out that they actually worshiped in it as well. So we thank, he sent Brother Croom to a couple of meetings, so we thank them for their input. Here again, there's nothing has stopped. So if anybody got anything history-wise they want to display, please make a copy and we'll post it in there as well. And then the representative we had from First Baptist of Zion, one and only Sister Faye Greyhouse, helped immensely. She was my proofreader. I always said if I could spell, I believe I could be a writer, but since I don't spell too good and arrange sentences so well, I had an English teacher that proofread all of the things that I wrote. So we had Sister Faye, and she enlisted it. Sister Bernice, Sister Candy Lewis. She got involved with it as well. In fact, the program that you have in your hand, I'm on top of her. Is Candy, are you here? You'll get the word that I just thank her and praise her for her efforts as well. Again, we'll ask our Sister Grundy to come and share just in a brief history of the church clerk as it relates to the building itself.
Giving honor to God, good afternoon. First Baptist is really rich in history. If you were not present this morning, Sister Gore gave highlights of that. And what I decided to do is focus on the building itself, where our roots were and still are, and carried over to here. Documentation supports that Mr. Samuel B. Jones' intention for the church and its use was that anyone who preached the gospel of Jesus Christ and his crucifixion shall have free access to preach therein, as stated in his last will and testament. We find that this building has been the incubator church for several local churches in the Marshtown area. The Presbyterian were the first to use the facility, followed by both the White Methodist and the White Baptist. These congregations built their own churches in the 30s. History records have confirmed the Union Church building deteriorated and succumbed to almost complete disuse as early as 1851. Free and enslaved African Americans started using the Jones Church as a place of worship. They assumed the responsibility for its upkeep and began a stewardship that has lasted to this day. Archives also revealed that St. John's African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church also worshiped in the old Jones building before and after the Civil War, alternating with the Colored Baptist until 1866. The trustees purchased Lot 1 from former Governor Charles A. Wycliffe for $250. The stained glass windows from the original building are still being used in their current church. Documentation also supports In 1866, the Union Church name was changed and became known as First Baptist Church, Burrstown, with Reverend Turner as its first pastor. And in front of the Union Church, you will see the historical marker that states, Union Church. This is the first brick church erected within the original city limits of Burrstown. The 1804 will of Samuel B. Jones directed that his possessions be sold and the money used to build a church for all Christian denominations. His wishes were carried out and the church was built 1812. Two lots were used for the cemetery. Congregations of the Presbyterian, Methodist, and Baptist met here until they built their own churches. After the Civil War, the African American Baptists began meeting here and assumed responsibility for its upkeep. It was enlarged and a bell tower was added in the late 1800s. Became home to First Baptist Church in 1860.
We had a lot of help with putting this project together over the last 6 months. It was a chore at times, but we made it all work. But I'd like to recognize, like I said, a few people here that actually did help us put this project together and make it happen on time. I guess the first people I need to thank is President Ralph Williams of the county got your back. And this fellow, they couldn't be here today, but he did send a nice flower here to welcome your church. We've got our own council people here this morning. Mr. Roland Williams, the councilman Keisha Copeland, along with council-elect the historical preservator himself, Mr. Joe Buckley. We got Mr. Penn Bogart with the Nelson County Historical Society with us today, Penn. We got Mr. Rashane Jennings, City Preservation Officer here with us today. And of course, Jewel had mentioned a few minutes ago all the other people that have really helped us quite a bit along with this project. We have Dollar Room and Reverend Roscoe Linton from the St. John's AME Zion Church. Tony and Carol Goodman from Burrstown Baptist, Linda Sodden and Sandy Anthony from the First Presbyterian Church, Ms. Dixie Hayes, of course, from United Methodist Church down here, who I know Jewel wore her out, the timelines and all the other stuff that she knows, but she's a wealth of information and we wanted to use it to our advantage. We've got our news media here with us today. We've got Sylvia Horland at WBRT, Jim Gross from the Nelson County Gazette, and Casey Good from Kentucky Standard. So we want to thank all of y'all for being here today. And last but not least, we got Mr. Bruce Vito and his lovely wife, Jill, who make sure I get timely invoices on time so we can pay all our good contract. You've done such a great job in helping us put this project together. So, we couldn't have done it without Bruce. And I'm gonna give him an opportunity to say a few words and recognize his good contracts to us. Bruce, good.
Most times a lot of fun, so bad. like to thank Jewel Brock, construction manager. He gave it. Jill Shackles, money man, and all the church for your unwavering support. Not one time was there a confrontation, a negative comment, none at all. We identified the problems we had to face, discussed the solutions, and executed a plan together. Job like this is based on mutual trust, because you can't just name what you're going to do to a church like this, because there's so many different things. It opens the door for strife, but one thing Jewel kept telling me over and over, he said, God has a hand in this. And he did. He had a big hand in this. I'd like to thank the Historic Society for helping us breeze through everything. Especially for Shay Jennings. She worked really hard to get us through the entire process. You know her, Shay, she's full of enthusiasm, very enthusiastic. Last, I'd like to thank the subcontractors. I'd like to thank the subcontractors for the work of the team to complete the project. There's no one person to do this project alone. I'd like to acknowledge these contractors and their crews for all the work they did. And I apologize to any crew members. I'm just going to miss the main contractors' names. And anyway, I'd like to start by thanking Mark and Benjamin Jury, father and son team. They helped me do the framing.
Happen to stand, here. Stand, whoever it is.
Oh, Mark and Benjamin Jury, if you're here, I don't think they're here. Their father and son team, once again, they worked with me for years. They do construction and framing, and they did a lot of interior and exterior repairs. Kyle Riggs, owner of Riggs Electrical, been working with them for a lot of years as well. Him and his crew are very professional, and they're always there when you need them. Lent Price, he's the owner of Outback Plumbing. Their work is always top notch. I've been working with them for years as well, and they've always done good work. Johnny Drury, he owns Comfort Air Control. Him and his crew do awesome work, and everything they do looks very clean and professional. Dennis Ahern, Chris Drone. They did all the drywall and insulation work. To these guys' credit, they worked through the hottest part of summer. And they were upstairs in the sanctuary when it was about 110 plus. It was hot as hot. They just kept pushing on, they got the job done. TNT Roofing, owner Evan Kohler. These guys are crazy. There's a bunch of old boards up there, neat old boards. Big wide, just took a whole tree and sliced it and just laid it on that roof. And but some of them rot. Your foot would go through and they just go right to the edges and hang over. Just maybe 20 years ago, but not even more. Leon Roundtree, he was our mason. He did the tuck pointing and brick repairs. They're very talented guys. The whole crew. Adam's Painting, Father Denny, Dan. Dan runs the show. Brother Robbie, who's a pretty good golfer if anybody likes to golf. These guys are great. They just kept painting. We beat up the walls. Well, some of some guys did it, wasn't me. Beat up the wall, and they just go back and fix it, and they never complained, they just kept working. Charlie Hagan. Charlie's been in my family since I was a kid. Anyway, he's about the only guy I know that can take a straight piece of trim and hang it on a crooked window and make it. Alright, Corbin Flooring, Jimmy Cronin, they did the flooring. Frank Welch, Welch Glass, I think everybody in Marshtown uses Frank. He worked really hard on finding the glass for the sanctuary. It was very tough to find. He found it up north somewhere. I'm not sure where, but it was great. Tommy Waldridge, he actually worked on the roof crew and then informed me that he did cabins. So he installed the cabins and did a fine job, giving the floor being out of them and everything. And I would like to apologize if somehow I've missed anybody. I'm sure I have. Please forgive me. I'd like to conclude once again, you the church, and the most of all God, who through which all things are possible.
Facilities, some actual pastors, since you've been here, you always had two facilities. Yes, you're correct. But what I'm saying is we have two working facilities. Amen. I'm gonna move quick. We got a couple more things to do, but my job is to recognize visitors, and I want to do that. And first, I guess like to recognize all the ministers or the pastors. If you're here, if you're a preacher, pastor, you just stand. Moment, don't just stand, sit back down, but stand so that I can see you. All the preachers and pastors, if you do it, stand on your feet. I want to steal your feet because I want everybody to know who you are. Just give you, if you got a church, if you pastor, just give you your name and your church. If not, just a minister, just give you your name so we can recognize you. We appreciate your time. Y'all get back up. As long as we got each other. And on up. Amen. So we're just delighted to have y'all come and preach and pastor the video. So thank you for coming and sharing with us. We'll start back here.
I'm Randall Pollock. I'm the pastor of Marshtown Baptist Church.
Amen. I'm Ernie Bagley, and I belong as Assembly of God ordained minister, but I have a chapel down in Glendale on Interstate 65 there, exit 86, to truck drivers on Sunday morning, Sunday night. And Brother Jewel and I, along with his lovely bride and Trish, we also go over to Danville to the prison and once a month, and I just enjoy the fellowship, the camaraderie. And when somebody hands you a personal invitation, wow, it's like Jesus Christ saying, I want you to be my child. And when Jewel handed me that personal invitation to be here today, I told my wife I was not going to miss.
I'm Reverend Roscoe Lynch, the pastor of St. John African Methodist Presiding Church.
Amen. Robert Coleman, retired pastor, First Baptist Church, Jefferson Dam. Been here for a number of hours. Amen, amen. I've been here every night. Amen. Eating up here all the time for a while, and George probably go cook well. And I left today, I left, I can't be that day. God bless you, real good, good, amen.
Freddie Griggs from Faith Worship Center.
Mike Caldwell, pastor at the right now at Pleasant Union Baptist Church in Campbellsville. I announced my call here and was ordained here by Reverend Coleman. I have a lot of members from here at First Baptist Church.
Amen.
John Sanderson, Pastor First Presbyterian Church.
Mr. Carl Harris, First Baptist Church, and the pastor, Mr. Mike Smith.
Certainly since I don't know some, but also give all of us opportunity if you're running around in the area on Sunday morning looking for church to worship. If you're not at home, you can stop by, like the young man said about the truck stop. I think it's unique. So you can go to services. Amen. Even if you're on the road. So I want to take time. It's important that those preachers, pastors come, even my own, they take time to stay. I want to take time to recognize them. So Pastor Chris, thank you all for coming and having us in this series for a moment. Give them give us a little. I want to recognize all of our business contract workers and all everybody that came and had something to do with the building. Thank you so very much. We love you. Thank you for your hard work. May God bless you. Keep praying for us. Anytime you're in this area, come and stop by and worship with us. We would have to have you. Amen. So we appreciate you, your presence. I did do it this morning. My sister's here. I love her. So Sister Anna Rita Smith is my sister. She comes quite a bit and she follows her brother. I want Sister to stand. Amen. She'll come out of the house and we're right together. All right. This is the last one. I'm going to see promise. Amen. I want to recognize my wife. Amen. First lady here, in case you don't know her name. Her name is Betty L. Smith. But we go way back. So Dr. Coleman, I call her Dr. Face. Nope, they call her Dr. Face. Here's my
speed up this train, passing the torch, so to speak. As stated earlier, that in the early 1850s, the Negro slaves, as well as free colors, which lived in the city limits, were permitted to congregate at the Union Church on Sunday to tell Bible stories and sing old songs. No one objected, so the slaves assumed the responsibility of the upkeep of Union Church. I'm going to say that again. No one objected, so the slaves assumed responsibility for the upkeep of the Union Church. Through the years, generation after generation did their part in its upkeep. Renovations after renovation, remodeling after remodeling, upgrade after upgrade, such as heaters, air conditioners, carpet, pews, electricity, indoor bathroom, gas stoves, sinks, hot water heaters, storm windows, the doors, and the baptism. They did their part in the upkeep. All prior generations, as well as this present generation, have done their part to preserve and continue the upkeep of this sacred building that our ancestors committed to upkeep over 165 years ago. now First Baptist, the torch is being passed, so to speak, and the responsibility for its upkeep is being passed to the next generation. And for that passing of the torch, so to speak, I need all of the members' assistance. I already have the little ones in the choir space. So the age groups that I'm going to ask for now to come up, I want you to come up. One, the first age group is anyone that's 70 years old and over. And I'm going to ask some of the brothers to help me get some chairs out here. We can sit. We don't want to have to go ahead and come up and step. So get a couple of chairs, two or three, we'll have a lot of many meals. Come up and just sit out front. This 70 plus year generation. And then while they're coming up, every member that's 50 years old and up to 70, or 69, I want you to come up and stand over in this area. 50, members of the 50 to 70, stand on that side. January of this year, they decided it is time Matter of fact, it's past time that we restore old faith. So many memories, so many memories. So they built a new church and have restored old faith. But it is our purpose of being here today to celebrate its newly renovated life. The torch is being passed from that generation to this generation. And Pastor, where you at? You assist me. Sister Brenda has the Bible. She has the word in which the church was originally built for, is the preaching and teaching of God's word. She, through good pastoral leadership, would now pass the torch through good spiritual leadership, such as our pastor, and he in turn would pass the responsibility to the next generation. Who in the next generation would take lead and become responsible for the upkeep that our ancestors started over 165 years ago, to maintain, as long as the building is solid and sound, to maintain its upkeep for the purpose of sharing God's word. Someone out of this group, take the lead. Present it to whomsoever will. All right. Let's give our hand. The reason I have the little ones in the back, well, I didn't think it was going to be, I thought it was going to be more room, I didn't know it was going to be this, but anyway, it's good to see you, buddy. To let them know, can you all hear me back there? Stand up. Can y'all hear me?
Yes, sir.
Usually about 20 or 30 years, a generation have maintained the upkeep of the building. And here again, going back up a little bit, not only is this generation here responsible, taking on the responsibility of its upkeep, generations, in case you all didn't know it, you all going to be responsible for the paying for it, too. Keep working. Younger generation, according to the histories of time, when things were done to the old church, the old building, by the time something else would need to be done, you all would be in that age group.
That's right.
You all will be the adults. So I solicit you to take on the responsibility. Go to school. Get your education so you can have a good job. So if anything that needs to be done to that old Union Church, then you're able to maybe get Bruce's grandson or something to do it. But keep hope alive, as I always say, but keep the history alive. Keep the memory alive. Remember who started the upkeep of that church. Slaves. They probably didn't even own the own house they lived in. So they took the ownership of that building, and it has carried through up until now. So don't let your generation be the generation where it stopped. So let's carry on and continue on in the upkeep of the old Union Church, so it can be used for the purpose that the person that gave it willed it free to be used for. Is she okay? All right. You all make quiet. Go back to your seats. Thank you. Can you all help me out? I'm not mistaken, Sister Furman is the oldest member, correct? Remember, make sure I get this right. I got to live here. She's 91, she said.
Yeah.
Okay, at this time, we ask Reverend Cooper to come and give us dedication of scripture, follow by dedication of prayer about the pastor. And we got one more thing, and we'll be out of here. These symbols, we can say them, not just kidding.
If you have your Bibles, will you turn with me to Psalms 122? Psalms 122.
How much where is that?
Psalms 122, the word is written. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Our feet shall stand within his gates, O Jerusalem. Jerusalem is built as a city that is compact together. Whether the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, unto the testimony of Israel, to give thanks unto the name of the Lord. For there are set thrones of judgments, and thrones of the house of David. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. They shall prosper that love thee. Peace within thy walls, and prosperity in thy houses. For my brethren and companions' sake, I will now say, peace be within thee. Because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek thy good. May God have a blessing to his holy word. In Jesus' name.
Prayer of dedication to you, bow your head where we are. And your saints will just bow. Our ask for this love of prayer. Gracious Father, we're so thankful and delighted what you're doing here at First Baptist Church in the city of Lordstown. God, thank you for opening our eyes and allowing us to walk by faith and not by sight. God, thank you for your kind and loving and powerful and sweet and forgiving God. Without you, we can do nothing. So God, we thank you for this dedication service. As we pray this dedication prayer, God, as we rededicate this historical building next door to us. A facility that has stood for over 200 years. And God, only you could allow it to happen. So for that, we are grateful. So God, we pray, we ask God that you would, in your own way, not only help us as we grow as a church, but by God's Spirit would just touch right now as we walk in those facilities. God, we thank you for the contractors that work with that labor week after week and month after month to get it up to code. And now we can be proud and walk in and worship, serve and do what we need to do, God. So let us stand 200 more years. If it be thy will, God, let us be faithful and let us be mindful of your doings that you did it, God. And so we are so grateful. Have First Baptist stand as a church in this dark community that she may be a healthy, thriving, growing church. That those souls that are lost might found you, God. So God, we thank you now, we dedicate those facilities. As we walk in, God, some who have not seen it, minds will be blessed and be so happy to see what you've done, God. We thank you that now we have two working facilities. We can worship in either one. And God, we know you'll be in our midst. So bless your people now. God, thank you for this dedication. Thank you for this ceremony. Those who are the sound of my voice, those that contribute, those that are here. Thank you, Lord. For you're so wonderful, we can say thank you all day long. But God, we're so grateful. Bless us and keep our hearts, God. Let us keep our minds staying on you. Like the people in Israel said, we have a mind to work. We got a mind
through our technician, our old church, want to speak to y'all about 10 minutes about what it is and be ready to go. Look at the monitors. You need this mic.
Thank you. Sister Kavana asked,
if the seniors would get in line first, so they get their meal first, and we'll call behind the senior members. She asked me to announce that, and I said I would. So if they don't go over, they'll go back and they'll get their meal, and we'll finish the tour, we'll come behind. And there's plenty, amen, and I am hungry, but it's plenty. So let's stay there. If you don't have to rush up, I know Dr. Coleman had a meeting, so he may not be able to stay. He had a meeting in J-Town. So we're going to bless the meal, and we'll tour the facility, and we'll eat. So follow those instructions. If you would, let our senior members get back first, and then we'll come behind. There's plenty, amen, and we're done for the day. And it's beautiful. I've been over this before. Okay. Again, let me thank everybody for coming, all the priests and pastors. Appreciate you all. Various churches coming. And I recognize our musicians, Jay and Lee, but JJ, Brother Michael Wright, and Jonah. We love these guys. Thank you all. I'm gonna say a prayer, but before I say the prayer, Reverend, I got something on program, Reverend, that I didn't put on. You got to excuse me, man. Come here. All right, come here, Reverend. Brother Bill. Amen. Reverend didn't know this. Well, come on out. Come on out here. You better stay. During our business meeting, last time we met, we church said we got in a debate about this building and didn't want to fall down. So Reverend Brock insisted he could mind being the lead person to get this stuff going and work hard. And he dedicated hours and precious time to this building and saw it, fit for it to get going. And we're grateful for that. Worked hard and still working hard. And the video and all that you've seen, before and after, he put his heart into it. We appreciate that. And me and Brother Bill was talking one Sunday back there. And I think Reverend kind of tipped off and he was saying how he dedicated and committed. And I've been preaching and teaching that. Folk don't like me to work commitment in church. Come on. But we don't want to commit. But Reverend Brock committed to this project. And I certainly appreciate that. Bill was saying, man, you know, work hard. It's coming along. We'll be ready for church anniversary. I said, wonderful. And he said, I think we ought to give man this flower like Bill's. And I said, you're right. And so we said this and that. And he said, Pastor, I'll take care of it. So, I know you've been holding like, what does he got? I got a plaque. Don't shout, brother. Y'all got some peanuts? It says recognition of appreciation. This recognition of appreciation is presented to Reverend Joel Brock, the First Baptist Church Board of Shepherd Tucker, for his steadfast determination to send to the development and completion of the Old Union Church and the Royal Henry Educational Center. We, the members of the First Baptist Church, and Reverend Michael E. Smith, want him to know of our heartfelt appreciation of all his hard work, dedication to seeing this project completed. Presented this 28th of November 2016 by Reverend Michael E. Smith, Senior Pastor, First Baptist Church, Boydstown, Kentucky. Those handed labor, those handed food. good God. Let us fellowship and enjoy it. Now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit. Father, we pray that you allow the restroom and the bath of us, henceforth and forevermore. Let us all say together, amen.